In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins unto God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sin. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Awake, why are you sleeping, O Lord? Rouse yourself, do not reject us forever. For our soul is bowed down to the dust. Rise up, come to our help. You, with your own hand, drove out the nations, but then you planted. You afflicted the peoples, but then you set free. In God we have boasted continually, and we give thanks to your name forever.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son.
Why are you sleeping, O Lord? Rouse yourself, do not reject us forever. For our soul is bowed down to the dust. Rise up, come to our help. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Take away all sin, our
Let us pray. O God, the strength of all who put their trust in you, mercifully grant that by your power we may be defended against all adversity. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament reading for sexagesima, about 60, is from Isaiah chapter 55. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I propose, and shall succeed in the thing which for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from Hebrews chapter 4. So then, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God, for whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. This is the word of the Lord. Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 8th chapter. When a great crowd was gathering and people from town after town came to Jesus, he said in a parable, a sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell along the path and was trampled underfoot, and the birds of the air devoured it. And some fell on the rock, and as it grew up, it withered away because it had no moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up with it and choked it. And some fell into good soil and grew and yielded 100-fold. As he said these things, he called out, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. And when his disciples asked him what this parable meant, he said, to you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of God. But for others, they are in parables, so that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand. Now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. The ones along the path are those who have heard. Then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved. And
And the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the word, receive it with joy. But these have no root. They believe for a while, and in time of testing fall away. And as for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and riches and pleasures of life, and their fruit does not mature. And as for that in the good soil, they are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart and bear fruit with patience.
This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O
a hundredfold. He who has ears to hear, Let him hear. Jesus binds his word to his creation. Living things are what Jesus speaks, and where Jesus speaks, there things live. And so you have to wonder what in the world those people that were not of Christ thought Christ was talking about when he preached the parable of the sower with its reckless sowing, throwing seed on the road, throwing seed on the rocks, throwing seed in the thorns. This guy is surely wasting that which is good. Would be much as the nonsense viewed the Christian church to those who know not the Christ in our day. What must they think when they go back into the mountains and hike in their splendor and their majesty, peering at it all? What must they think as they look at their fingers move or their newborn child laugh? What emptiness must be in their mind and in their soul, similar to those listening to Jesus' nonsensical sermon about throwing seed here and there and everywhere. Jesus is always talking about the creation because Jesus' word is in the creation. Jesus' word has made the creation. Jesus is life, and when he speaks, there is life. So you take some seed, it looks dead, but in it is life. You take some seed that looks dead, you add water, you add sun, and the next thing you know, it feeds a multitude, but yet it looks dead. Then on the other hand, you take the world looking at God's creation, life all around in its beauty and in its splendor. And what do they prefer? Not something that looks dead, but that's living. They prefer that which is dead and declare somehow that makes things alive. Run over a squirrel. You either help the evolutionary track along or you just kill a squirrel. The scholars of the world, they say, well, that's life right there, dead in the middle of the road. That's life. And something good's going to come from you splattering that squirrel on the road and on your bumper. So just do it again because it helps all things live. So the world that sees the creation of the Christ and is in utter darkness, yet it is all around them. Who could look at a tree or the ocean or some of the splendors in them, those things that live, and think they come from nothing or from death? Who could watch some of the astounding things that we find in our own backyards or in the zoo or on the animal planet and say these things are fearfully and wonderfully made by nothing, nothing whatsoever? And so the word is in all things because the word was spoken and all things were. God said, beast of the field, and there was beast of the field. God said, sun in the sky, and there was sun in the sky. God said, let there be light. It was so, and his word fills all things. It's been thrown everywhere. Places where people believe and places where people believe it not. they are without excuse, for the heavens and the earth are the work of the Christ. They're without excuse because they whistled merrily along or not so merrily along, not knowing their Creator and their Redeemer, the one that brings forth life with his death and life. So the world, it doesn't know what's going on, but yet the seed is sown for all the world. And so you know they'll reject the word of Christ. And maybe from time to time you reject the word of Christ. So gracious gift upon gracious gift, Jesus spreads the seed everywhere without exemption, so that it might fall on all places and all people might have life in his name. Jesus at this point has called the disciples. Jesus has granted them the marvelous catch of fish. Jesus has spoken, and those who were blind were able to see, and those who were demon-possessed and could not speak had the demons cast out, and their tongues were once more filled with song. Jesus had been doing astounding things, and therefore they lent him their ear. Maybe it was an annoying breaking in of a preaching when they really wanted an acting, but they humored him nonetheless. And so to a people that were of the earth, shepherding the flocks and planting for the harvest, this seems to be nonsense. This Christ, this carpenter, talking about simple things when we want him to do mighty things. This guy binding his word to seed and sowing and growing. Nonsense, they must have thought. Give us what we want, they later demand. But the church knows that the word of Christ is better than all things, resurrection and life for us. So his disciples, taught by the Holy Spirit, were led to ask, what do these things mean? And so they asked him what these things mean. He said, the seed is the word of God, the powerful word that is bearing fruit in the lives of those who are my own. I get distressed, maybe you do. I particularly get distressed not for my sake, but for the children's sake, my children and your children. Parents are totally lame these days. They used to be more disciplined. They used to care more about what their children might be. They taught a work ethic. They taught them to be honorable. They taught them to be respectful and polite. I'm falling down on the job, and things are worse now than they used to be a generation before. I'm distressed for the children that color in church and don't lift their ears to the gospel. I'm distressed for the child who hasn't been taught to pray in his home. I'm distressed for the child that's sent to the school that says all things came from dead roadkill. And that's the wonder of this life, so deal with it, child. I'm distressed for them. And so this text is a beautiful, beautiful thing if you're distressed anything like me. The seeds thrown everywhere in the world, that means every child in the world has an opportunity to search their soul and know that they've been made by God, and to see him on the cross in the person of Christ, God in our flesh. The seed has been sown, and though it's opposed, in all respects, it does bear fruit. St. Matthew says 30 here, 60 there, 100. you're a Christian, if you're connected to Christ and hearing his word, blessing will be known in your life and in those you live in, your family, your children, your heritage. Not a small, pitiful blessing in this world, but a magnificent, beautiful multiplication in your life. God's word, it extends a wide, wide circle. And so you might just have a few. But if you're grounded and you're washed in God's word, if you're planted in it and you remain, you can know that a wide circle will extend from your home and from your person, because Christ has forgiven you and Christ has guarded you, that so it might be. So let everything go that goes, murders and abuses, physical and sexual, torture, all sorts of terror that is our lives that we want to stuff up our ears over against. And instead, open your ears to this, that Christ plants in the world Christians, and from them bears much, much fruit. And so pray and be planted in him, and know that your heritage and your effect in this world will be beautiful, and it will be much, and it will even be seen by you and hopefully for others who know not the God in human flesh and the God in creation, that they might also come with us and rejoice in the planting of Christ Jesus. It is a powerful word, such that Jesus says to those who don't get it, you know not the gospel, nor the power therein. And for us who are slow to believe, we know not the gospel, nor the power therein, when trouble comes to our home. If we would simply believe the promises of the Christ, then all so much would be better, and there would be no worries that could be false. You know not the gospel, nor the power therein, which is Jesus saying the gospel is full of power. So it's become my go-to line when somebody comes to complain about their husband, or when somebody comes to complain about their wife. Did Jesus speak? And did everything come into being from nothing? Did that happen? Yes, Pastor. It did happen. Well, then do you think Jesus could speak to you and you might be able to love your husband once more? Well, yes, Pastor, I guess it could be so. Did Jesus speak? And did Jesus work in the life of Adam and in the life of Eve? And he promised them a Savior and gave all the world to them just with his voice. Yes, he did. Well, then can great things be known to you who have the word of Christ forgiving you and strengthening you and planting his spirit in you? Well, yes, it can. You mother that are at your end, or your father that can't figure out how to keep it all together, is the word of Christ powerful or isn't? Does he promise to bring fruit forth from his homes and his children, or doesn't he? So trust his word and pray that he would grant you to trust it more and more as all things turn to chaos and fall apart, and know that it won't for you, because your eternal life is secure by this, the Son of God. A heritage, a future, something to look forward to in this life, but especially in the life that is to come, the word of God planted in us and blessed. the Son of God, suffering in this life, which is hard, which leads us to forsake instead of hold to the Christ. Of course, the text has warnings, and us Christians ought to know them well. The devil is true, so he has to be answered in the Son of God. The devil is true, so place your blame on your own sin, or your own love of his works, or on his person, and not on the Son of God who has created and redeemed you. Suffering is real, but the word of God is not to be forsaken in the midst of suffering. It's to be clinged to and sung forth all the more. It lays in us as though dormant, like a seed, but soon it bursts forth and shines in beauty. And that's what our bodies will know out of this suffering in the life that is to come. St. Peter obviously heard this sermon. He picks up on it in his epistles, the devil roaring around like a roaring lion. Surely that's born out of the sower. 2 Peter, you heard it on the day of the transfiguration, the word of God. It is powerful for us, but in the last days, people will use it to make cash or to explain those sexually depraved things that they do. St. Peter hears. So we are warned in this text, and we're guarded by this text to be aware of these things and to cling to God's word in the midst of these things. If you are suffering, then God's word is your health. If you're suffering and the Lord Christ allows it, well, then something more important than health must be known in this life, the suffering of Christ in our stead and for us. If you're in love with the world, well, quit it, and quit it now, and instead be in love with Jesus and his word, so that your children and your children's children might stand before the throne with you. If the devil torments your soul, then have the Spirit soothe your soul with the precious word of the gospel, which has been thrown into all the world for those for whom your hearts bleed and for your heart too. The sower went out to sow some seed. Life has been bound to life in this creation, and from this creation comes forth those things which are living through the word of God, which is living and active for you. So may it guard your hearts this day and always. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Almighty Father in heaven, you are the maker and provider of all things. Lead us to know this and to receive your gifts with thanksgiving. Free us from the cares of this world and set our hearts and minds on the saving work of your Son, Jesus Christ. grant that your word may take root in us, that we may solely depend on you for all our needs of body and soul, and remain faithful unto death. Almighty God, you promise that your word will not return to you empty. Raise up men within your church to become faithful pastors. Strengthen them to generously spread the gospel throughout the world, so that by your Holy Spirit's work, many will receive eternal life. Kind Father, your Son suffered unto the death for our transgressions. Defend all Christians who are persecuted for his name's sake, that they may rejoice as they share in his suffering, hold firmly to their faith, and bear their cross until the day they behold him in his kingdom. Mighty King, apart from our Lord Jesus, we can do nothing. By your Holy Spirit, lead us to serve one another within your church, to love our enemies, and to care for our neighbors with sincere hearts. Grant that all our works may be done in love and bring glory to your holy name. Almighty God, you sent your Son into the flesh to be our Savior. He has promised to be with us always until the end of the age. Strengthen and preserve us this day as he comes to us in his holy supper. Deliver to us the forgiveness of sins as we receive his holy body and blood, that through this meal we may obtain everlasting life. Merciful One, you gave your Son to bear our grief and carry our sorrows. Give comfort to those who are sick, taking treatments, and to the dying. Especially today we name Robert Gunn. Ease his pain and all those whom we love, and remove their anxiety. May they know the comfort and peace of your forgiving love. Into your hands, O Heavenly Father, we commend all for whom we pray, asking you to grant us these things and whatever else you know to be needful for us. We ask it in the holy name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Welcome to all of you this morning. We pray God's rich blessing be upon you as we celebrate now the sacrament of Christ's body and blood, Christ binding himself to simple things, bread and wine for the forgiveness of sins for the world. Announce we do so in service to his word. We practice it, the serving of the supper, as he would have us do, closed communion. If you're visiting with us this day, if you would like to receive the gifts in full of this parish, please do speak to us following the service. If you have some question or need, you might take a moment to fill out the visitor card in your pew. Not heard of this serving of the supper before, there's more information in the front of your bulletin.
Thank you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection open to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
depart in peace.
Thank you.
Depart in peace.
Body of Christ for you. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.